evils abound. When the sun's come to pass, there's the end at last. It will come very fast, trumpets will sound. Jesus coming soon, morning or night or noon. Many will leave their doom, trumpets will sound. All the
Amen.
On that shore, Amen. Amen.
I made it. Thank God I made it. I'm not on an ego trip. I'm nothing on my own. I make mistakes, I often slip. Just common flesh and bone. But I'll prove someday just why I say I'm of a special kind. For when he was on the cross, I was on his mind. The look of love was on his face. The thorns were on his head. He even wore a scarlet robe and stained it crimson red. Though his eyes were on the crowd that day, he looked ahead in time. For when he was on the cross, I was on. For he knew me, yet he loved me. He whose glory makes the heavens shine. So
chapter number 11. Hebrews chapter number 11. And we'll start reading verse number 7. So when you find your place, if you're able and willing to stand in reverence to God's word, Hebrews chapter number 11, and start reading in verse number 7. The Bible says, by faith Noah, being warned of God of things not seen as yet, moved with fear, prepared an ark to the saving of his house, by the which he condemned the world and became heir of the righteousness which is by faith. And let us pray. Heavenly Father, God, thank you so much, Lord, for everything you've already done, God, for the young man that got saved, Lord, and God, for just giving us revival, Lord, refreshed and renewing our minds and restoring our joy, God, our burden, our zeal for you, Lord, just to rest in you. I thank you for that, God. Lord, I thank you for the opportunity to be here tonight. God, you know my heart. You know the heart of everyone here. And I pray, God, you just help me to get out of the way. God, help me to be obedient to you, to preach your word for your honor and glory. And God, you take and you'd help those here tonight in a special way. God, there's someone here never been saved. Lost and undone. God, would you convict their heart? Draw them to you that this might be the night they get saved by your amazing grace. Lord, please encourage the saints of God. Strengthen us and challenge us. Help us to be what you'd have us to be. Lord, thank you for loving us. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. You may be seated. All right, friend. My way of introduction here in this scripture, God reminds us in the New Testament of one known real well in the Old Testament, in the book of Genesis, a man by the name of Noah. You'll find Noah the day he lived in. It wouldn't really be ideal for anybody to volunteer to want to live in the day he lived in. You'll find that mankind was just wicked, that God looked upon the earth and the earth, man was corrupt and the earth was filled with violence. It was a dangerous time. I mean, you talk about probably the murder, the malice, the hatred, the violence, the depravity of mankind. God looked on the heart of man, said their thoughts of their heart was only evil continually, and it repented the Lord that he made mankind. And you think about how horrible, how scary of a time it must have been to live in Noah's day. And then on top of that, on top of everything he could see, the filth, the vile, the violence, all those things, the sin, the fornication, the adultery, the sons of God lying with the daughters of men and warriors and fuss and fighting, all the chaos going on in the world at that time, everything he could see was enough to try and make somebody go crazy. And then on top of that, you'll find that there was also something coming that he could not see. Something that the world had not seen as of yet. And you talk about getting his attention. What God said, I believe in Genesis 6 and verse number 16. There was something that was going to come that man had never seen before. That he never experienced. He didn't know what to do. Didn't know how to go about it. And that thing that they could not see was going to come and take the breath of life out of mankind. Amen. The breath of life that God had breathed into man to allow him to live and dwell on earth. And God said, I'm going to send a flood to destroy the earth, the inhabitants thereof. And he said, it's going to flood with water. And those men's lungs and women and boys and girls, we're going to get filled up with water until they can no longer breathe and they're going to be out of here. He was in the midst of a world pandemic on their hands. Something that they could not see, and it was going to take their breath out of them. If something didn't happen, something did change, friend. You'll find how he no respond. You'll find there it said, by faith, being warned of God, moved with fear. He was moved with fear. So with God's help, why I won't preach on here tonight, is what fear is moving you. What fear is moving you and I here tonight. You see, friend, in the Word of God, talking about the coming of the Son of Man, it says, as in the days of Noah, so shall it also be in the days and the day of the coming of the Son of Man. Right. He's saying when the Lord's getting ready to come back, it's going to be like Noah's day. Yeah, and you and I can acknowledge that all the fussing and fighting, all the chaos, all the corruption, all the confusion in the world, and on top of that, being in a pandemic of something that we cannot see, a virus that is threatening the lives of everyone to take their breath away. We're living in a society right now where many are being moved by fear. My initial reaction response is to be afraid. I mean, to get full of anxiety, confused, tore up, not knowing which way to go, what to do. They're fearful. They're afraid. And that fear moves them to do things they had never done before. To start being confused, to start doubting. I mean, friends, somebody gets a sore throat. Somebody starts running a slight temperature. Somebody's nose starts running. Somebody coughs or sneezes, and everybody's in panic. Pandemic is constant panic, and fear is moving them. Then all of a sudden, they're practicing social distancing, putting on masks, staying quarantined, isolated, trying to get in a bubble, trying to hide in a basement because fear is moving them. They're afraid, friend. I mean, friend, it's gotten so bad that they got people afraid to go to church. They're afraid if I go to church, I might get the virus and I might die. Maybe if I've got it, I might go and accidentally give it to somebody. Moved with fear, being afraid, wondering what if, what might happen. Messes with our feelings, our emotions, our minds, our thoughts, being moved with fear because of something that we cannot see. But it's saying it's going to take our breath away. It's going to take our life away. Some respond by fear, being afraid. There's others moved with fear that they get on the attack. They get angry. They get violent. They get hostile. Maybe into the point of causing anarchy. See, there's some moved by fear so much that if they thought you had the virus and you come trying to come in their house, they're liable to shoot you. They're liable to put you under because they're afraid that they might lose their breath, might be taken away. They're moved by that fear. They might die. There's some that use the fear of the pandemic as an opportunity to cause anarchy, to start committing abominations, for lawlessness, to start rioting and looting and burning down buildings and fighting and shooting and killing. Just like in the days of Noah. And whenever it gets that way, being moved with fear, you'll find anarchy starts to take place. Everybody's afraid. Everybody's terrified. I mean, a panic is set in, and everybody is starting to be controlled. They're being moved by that fear. And many, because of anarchy and fear, they start to want to turn against authority. They start to want to blame God. Get angry at politicians to abolish the police, to abolish authority, so they can try to do it however they want to, however they feel, however they think, being moved by fear, friend. What fear is moving you and I here tonight? You'll find, friend, that there's two different kinds of fear in the Word of God. There's the fear of this flesh, the fear of this world, as I just described. The first message I ever preached, as a preacher here in this pulpit was Satan's what if. To sow fear, doubt, discouragement, regret, confusion, thoughts of failure in our hearts and minds to try to control us with fear. What if this happens? What if that happens? Many people are moved by that fear. What if President Trump gets reelected? What if Joe Biden gets elected? What if the virus gets worse? What if the rioting and all gets worse? What happens if somebody comes with a virus? What happens if I have it and I don't know it and I give it to someone else and they die? What if all the fear that can move us? You'll find the fear of the world and of the flesh. It'll move us. It'll start to control us. You'll find the children of Israel in a situation they'd never been in before. They didn't know how to respond. God brought them out of Egypt. They're following Moses and the Lord. And they come to the Red Sea. Instead of it seemed like a bright sunny day to lay by the beach, they look and say, how are we going to get over? There ain't no boat. There ain't no bridge. What are you thinking, Moses? And they turn around, and guess what? They see Pharaoh coming. And they're afraid, and fear begins to move them. All they can think about is they're going to drown. Pharaoh's going to take their life. They start murmuring. They start crying out to the Lord. It says there in Exodus 14, about 10, they were sore afraid. They start telling Moses, is this not what we told you, Moses? Is this not why we told you getting angry at the authority? They're afraid. They're sore afraid. They're ready to try to do things their own way. They say, we told you to leave us alone. For it had been better off with us. We'd have stayed back in Egypt than for us to come out here and die in the wilderness. And you know what Moses told them? He said, to fear not.
Fear not to be still, to stand and see the salvation of the Lord. He's saying, don't be afraid. Don't let this kind of fear control you and move you. Dominate our minds and our hearts and our decisions. But if we ain't careful, fear, it'll move you and I. It'll control our minds, our actions, our thoughts, our desires. It'll control everything about us. That's what Satan and the world want. That's what politicians want. Sowing fear. If Trump gets elected, it's going to be horrible. I mean, the world's going to fall apart. There'll be wars. The virus will get worse. All these things trying to make you afraid to vote for that man. Right. Then the opposite is saying, if Joe Biden gets elected, the economy will tank. He'll raise taxes. It'll get bad. We'll get taken over by communists. All just sowing fear to try to control our vote. Trying to move us, our mind, our thoughts, our actions in the midst of things we can't see and don't know. Satan says, what if? Sometimes we think we're living by common sense. Sometimes that common sense is really fear instead of living by faith. You'll find the children of Israel, after God parted the Red Sea and they walked across on dry ground, you'd think that would be enough right there. And you'd think after 10 plagues and the blood on the lintel and the doorpost and the Red Sea parting, go across on dry ground and turn around and watch Pharaoh drown and shout in the victory, you'd think that would be enough to not let fear move them. But then they come time to go into Canaan land, to possess the land. Caleb stilled the people before Moses there in Numbers 13 about verse 30. He said, let us go up at once and possess it, for we are well able to overcome them. He said, God promised it to us. Let's go right now. Don't be afraid. He said, don't rebel. Don't fear and rebel, but let's go obey God. But they let fear move them. And they said, we be not able to go up against them. We'd be not able to overcome them. We can't possibly go where God has commanded us to go. If we do that, those giants in the land are going to kill us. We're grasshoppers. They're giants. They're going to stomp us like a bunch of bugs. It's not possible. The scientists say we can't win. The war strategists say we can't overcome them. My feelings, my flesh, my emotions say, I cannot do it. And fear moved them. And they rebelled against God. Instead of doing what God said, they rebelled and let that fear move them and control them. And if we're not careful, that kind of fear, it'll move us too. And it'll control us. Start making us second guess doing something for God. Start making us doubt, getting confused, getting afraid, getting discouraged. Next thing you know, we're in a mess, friend. But you know what? Noah, he was moved with a different kind of fear. See, by faith, Noah, being warned of God, moved with fear. Moved with fear. You know what kind of fear Noah had? He wasn't afraid. He wasn't committing anarchy. He wasn't trying to abolish authority. He wasn't trying to do it his way or the highway. But you'll find he had fear of God in his heart. Amen. The fear of the Lord, a reverential awe towards God and God's authority. And in spite of how he felt, in spite of what was going on around him, by faith Noah would obey God because he was moved by fear. Amen. What he's saying. See, the fear of the world, the fear of the devil puts in our hearts and minds, it's all based on feelings and emotions. Right. What man says, what might happen, what someone else says, someone else's opinion, whether they got degrees or education or not, it's uncertain. But you'll find being moved by the fear of God is always based upon fact and what thus saith the Word of God. You see, Noah was in the same world they were, but the fear that moved him was the fear and reverence toward God Almighty, and he would act upon his faith and being moved by that fear to prepare an ark. You'll find Genesis 6 and 22. But Noah did all that God, according to all that God had commanded him. So did he. He obeyed God because he was moved with that reverential fear of God, that awe towards God Almighty, God's authority. Instead of being moved by fear of how we feel, what man says. No, his life, his decisions, his actions was based upon the fear of God. That is what moved him. That was what was his thoughts, his heart, his mind, his decision, his actions was to obey God no matter what. Obey God no matter what. You see, sometimes faith in God and fear of God is going to go beyond common sense. It's going to go beyond science. It'll go beyond doctors. It might go beyond our parents' opinions. It might go beyond someone else's thoughts or feelings. Obeying God, friend, will be based upon fact and God's word, and it'll lead us to make steps by faith. For the just shall live by faith. We're not to be afraid. Some examples in the word of God. Think about Moses. Guess what God told Moses to do? He said, Moses, I know you're out here on the backside of the desert keeping sheep. I've been preparing you, making you ready. I know you don't think you're ready. I know you can't do it on your own. But I want you to go to the most powerful ruler in the world at this time. I want you to walk up to Pharaoh and look him in the eye and say, thus saith the Lord, let my people go. And you can only imagine everybody saying, Moses, that ain't a good idea. Sign says if you don't agree with Pharaoh, he'll cut your head off. He'll throw you in a den of lions. He'll burn you alive. I mean, don't do it. Moses, don't do it. But he was moved by fear of who God was. Because God said, tell him I am, has sent thee. Tell him I am, has sent thee. So he was moved by fear of God's authority. And he acted upon it by faith to obey God no matter what. You'll find, I believe, in 1 Samuel chapter number 17, I believe is right. You'll find there was a giant, a champion named Goliath, undefeated, by the way. So the statistics say there's a zero chance that you're going to be able to defeat the giant. And guess what the children of Israel and the armies of Israel were doing? They fled. They was afraid. The giant was just saying, one man, just one man be willing to fight me. We'll sell this once for all. They're all running away. They're saying, we can't do it. Everybody's come against us. He's beat them. He's destroyed them. There's no chance. We got to run. Everybody hide, tell him hide. And guess what David said? He said, who's this uncircumcised Philistine think he is to defy the armies of the living God? He said, let no man's heart fail because of him. I will go up and fight this Philistine. I'll take the battle to him. How was David going to do it? He was moved by fear and faith in God. He said, I come before you in the name of the Lord of hosts. And the same God that delivered him out of the mouth of the lion and out of the bear would be the same God that would deliver the giant into his hand, because he was moved with fear of God and he obeyed God by faith, regardless of what was popular opinion, regardless of the past, regardless of what it looked like. He's willing to be moved by fear, friend. You'll find when I start thinking about this coronavirus, you start thinking about what might happen if we come to church and get it. Or maybe somebody comes and gives it to somebody else. And then it can stop a whole lot of people from coming. And I'm not condemning nobody. I'm not here to throw rocks. What you do as an individual, we're to work out our own salvation with fear and trembling. We're going to give an account to God for how we live our life, the choices we make. I'll give an account to God for this message that I'm preaching before you tonight. So I'm not taking it lightly. But would we still come to church if we do get taken over by communists? And they say it's against the law to go to church. If you go to church, we'll hang you. If you go to church, you'll be shot. If you go to church, you'll be put in prison. What are we going to be moved by? Are we going to be moved by the fear of the world and say, oh, can't go to church no more because I don't want my breath to be taken away, because I don't want to suffer, I don't want to break the law or get put in jail or be murdered or persecuted or afflicted. What fear is going to move us? Because see, you'll find the devil is subtle. He's a deceiver. He's clever. And he'll redo the same thing he's already tried before. He's already done in the book of Daniel, chapter number 3, saying you can't go and worship God no more. It's not good for the country. It's not good. We're going to set up a golden image for you. That way you can practice social distancing. You can just watch it on the screen there. I'll set it up for you, and we'll even play music, and you bow down and worship the golden image. And if you don't, we'll throw you into a burning fiery furnace. What fear was going to move them? Common sense would say, well, I want to breathe, amen. Fire is hot. I don't want to burn. So I ain't going to do it. I'm going to do whatever they say. I'll worship a golden statue, no matter how ridiculous it may be. I'll worship an idol. I'll turn Muslim. I'll turn Catholic. What if? What fear is going to move us? But there was three Hebrew boys. You know what they said? We're going to reverence God Almighty and God's authority. And we're going to act by our faith in who God is and what God says and what God can do and will do. And they said, O King Nebuchadnezzar, we're not careful to answer thee concerning this matter. For our God is able to deliver us out of the burning fiery furnace. And O King, he will deliver us out of thine hand. But if not, be it known unto thee, we're still not going to bow down to that golden image that you set up. They say we're moved by fearing God and what God's word says, and we're going to go by faith. We're going to go by faith. Daniel was the same way. They told Daniel, you can't go to church no more, and you can't pray in Jesus' name anymore. You can't pray to nobody but to the King. What did Daniel do? Was he moved by fear? What am I going to do now? How am I going to not be able to pray? What am I going to do? Are they going to arrest me? Am I going to die? Are they going to take my breath away? You know what he did? He just did as he always done before, 3 times a day. He knelt down at his window open toward Jerusalem, toward the temple, toward the house of God, and prayed toward God. His heart was after God. He wasn't afraid of being thrown into a den of lions for him. He was moved by the fear of God, reverential awe, and he acted upon it by faith against common sense, against scientists, against doctors, against public opinion, against the law. He was moved by the fear of God, and he acted upon it, friend. You know what God wants out of our hearts and lives? He doesn't want us to run around in fear. Fear of what might happen. What if this happens? See, mankind has gotten so foolish in becoming his own God that we've got to a point where we think we can control and choose who lives and who dies. How is that possible? Because they'll abort millions and millions of our innocent unborn babies thinking that they don't deserve to live, that their life doesn't matter, whether they're black or white, red or yellow, whatever, they're aborting them, murdering them, saying we don't want them to live. And then they think we got the power to put on masks, wash our hands just right, and nobody will get sick and nobody will die. If we don't go to church and don't pray and don't get out in public, nobody will die. Friend, we don't have the power to keep somebody alive. We can't give life. It ain't up to us to take away life, friend. We're to be moved by fear. If we could really keep somebody from getting sick, don't you think we would already done it and our hospitals wouldn't be full? Don't you think, friend, if we really knew how to keep somebody from getting cancer, that nobody would get it? Friend, they're being moved by the wrong fear. But God wants us to be moved by fear that acts upon faith and obeys God. So Noah prepared an ark. You know what he did? He took heed to God's warning or God's alarm. He took heed to God's authority. What God said, something he had never seen, something no one else listened to, everyone else mocked and ignored him. But he took heed to God's alarm. And I just wonder here tonight, we'd be moved by the fear of God. That there is something out there, a plague, that we cannot see, that's going to take our breath away, that's going to cause us to die. And you know what? You're born with it. For all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. For the wages of sin is death, death, death. And whosoever's name's not found written in the book of life is cast in the lake of fire. The second death. Wouldn't it be good if people were moved more by the fear of God? And instead of being concerned about this physical life, they got more concerned about where they're going to spend eternity and body and soul and spirit, friend, and be moved by fear of God and take heed to God's warning and God's alarm, moved by the fear of God. Because he listened, Noah prepared the ark. There was going to be a way of escape. There was going to be a way of salvation, a way to live. And it was to get inside that ark, friend. And you and I, they're saved by the grace of God. That ark is Jesus Christ. And what fear is going to move us? I thank God as a little 10-year-old boy, I bowed to fear of the flesh. I bowed to fear of the world. I thought to myself, what if I get up and everybody knows I'm lost? What if I get up and everybody knows I've sinned? I was so backward and shy. I was afraid to ask the lady sitting next to me if she'd move her legs over so I could go to the altar and get saved. I was being moved and controlled by fear. But I thank God I heard a warning. I thank God I heard the warning before I saw it. Before I saw hell. Before I felt the flames. And being moved by fear of God, afraid of going to hell and need to be saved. By faith I acted upon the word of God and the spirit of God drawing me, and I got in the ark. I got in Jesus Christ, sealed, safe, and secure for all eternity, friend. Moved by fear, I got birth in the family of God. What fear? How many people think what might happen if I get saved? What if my boyfriend leaves? What if my girlfriend leaves? What if life's no fun? What if I can't party no more? What if I can't get over drinking and doping and carousing and all these things? And they'll let that fear control them. And they'll ignore the judgment of God is coming. It is coming like we've never seen before in fire and brimstone and eternity of damnation. We need to be moved by fear, friend. The reverential awe of God. That we're going to obey God by faith, not by fear of man, not by people's opinions or thoughts, not by false prophets, not false preachers, according to what they say of the Word of God. You know what, friend? I thank God and give God the glory. Pretty much all the greatest blessings and decisions I've made in my life, when I've made them by faith, it went against what people thought. It rippled in a wheelchair as a 19-year-old boy. Did not make any sense. My parents were afraid. They didn't think it was a good idea. Her parents were afraid. Thinking it never worked. It's too much responsibility. It'll be too hard. You just can't do it. Doctors say she won't live long. It'll be too hard. Won't be able to make enough money. How will you be able to have kids or enjoy life? The fear of the flesh and the fear of man. But you know why I married Amber? It wasn't because I thought I could do it on my own. It wasn't to please anybody. It was because of fear of God that by faith, I believed in my heart that she was the one God wanted me to be with. And I thank God we got married. Praise God. I would have missed out on 9 of the greatest years of my life if I would have walked by fear of the world instead of the fear of God, friend. When it come time to having Marcus, moved by fear of the world, fear of God. Doctors say it's high risk. Patient in a wheelchair, complications, blood pressure trouble. It's likely to not work, to fail, could lose her life, the baby's life. Not advise you to do it, scientifically and medically. But instead of listening to the fear of man and the world, obey God by faith, amen. The next thing you know, here's a 10-year-old boy that wouldn't be here tonight had I listened to man or doctors or science. Instead of God and the desire he placed in my heart, friend, my faith moved by the fear of God. You say, preacher, why are you preaching here tonight? You know, I could fall on my face. I could get shot. I could get persecuted. I could get sick. I could make an embarrassment of myself. I could get locked up and thrown in jail or lose my life for the cause of Christ. But friend, I'm not here preaching because of results. I'm not here preaching for money or fortune or fame or popularity. The number one reason why I stand before you tonight is the fear of God, that God called me to preach what thus saith the Word of God. And that's why I'm here tonight, regardless of what man says or public opinion, to be moved by fear and faith toward God and obey and do whatever God calls you to do, friend. We need to act upon the Word of God, God's authority, because we're going to give an account to God for our life. If God leads on your heart for you to not come to church because you're sick, you got a fever or something, you obey God. It's going to be between you and the Lord. If I knew I had the flu, I wouldn't be shaking Miss Rosie's hand and trying to give her a hug. I'd be staying away. But I can't live wondering what if, because there's so many unknowns that could happen that it's impossible to live for God, to live defeated and doubted and by fear. We're going to have to go by fact, what's certain, what we can count on. And when we do that, trust God with the results. Not up to us, not man's reasoning, but trust God with the results. Noah acted upon it. He prepared the ark. I wonder if you're here tonight and you ain't saved. Are you in the ark? Are you in the ark? And child of God, we act like this coronavirus can really take somebody's breath away. And we care and we don't want nobody to get sick and die. And yet we know for a fact that there is a burning literal hell of torment for the lost and wicked and undone. And our loved ones are dead in trespasses and sins. And may to God we be moved by the fear of God enough that we try to get our family in the ark with us, friend. That we try to reach them for the cause of Christ. I think about lost people right now. They could come to church and they might get the virus. They might get sick physically. But a lost person could also come and hear the gospel preached and get saved by the grace of God. And which is better, friend, which is better? I thank God when I was lost and undone. Instead of my parents being afraid to bring me to church, I thank God they brought me underneath the Word of God and the gospel, and I could be saved. I could get in the ark, friend. I could get in the ark. You know what's the blessing about being in the ark? Knowing others are in the ark with you. And you obey God like Noah. Everything's going to be all right. You know what's amazing about it? God tells us in Isaiah 43:2, when thou passest by the waters, I will be with thee. And through the rivers, they shall not overflow thee. Thou walkest through the fire, thou shalt not be burned, neither shall flame kindle upon thee. And he says in Isaiah 43:5, he says, fear not, for I am with thee. Yeah. Well, he tells the child of God, you might go through the flood. You might go through suffering. You might go through a storm. You might go through the flood. Might go through the Red Sea. You might have to cross over Jordan. But God's saying, I'll be right there with you. It won't overflow you. You're not going to drown. You're going to be okay. You might be like the three Hebrew boys getting thrown in the burning fiery furnace. And God says, it's all right. You're going to be all right. Because fear not, for I am with thee. God says, don't be afraid of this world. Don't be afraid of the devil or the flesh, the lust thereof. But fear God and keep His commandments. That's the whole duty of man. Fear thou not, for I am with thee. Be not dismayed, for I am thy God. I will strengthen thee. Yeah, I will help thee. Yea, I will uphold thee with the right hand of my righteousness. Being in the ark, fearing God is the best place to be. And then you'll find there in the book of Genesis, you'll find there in the Word of God, as Noah was building the ark, God said, put a little window and put it in above, about 1 cubit, I believe. And all I could think about is being inside that ark and not being able to see around you, not being able to see the flood, not knowing what's going to happen, what everything going to take place. But God taught Noah to be moved by fear and faith. He said, you just keep looking up. We just keep looking up. He tells us, friend, when we see these things come to pass, to lift up your heads, to look up, your redemption draweth nigh. He's letting us know, no matter what we're going through, just look to God by faith. Just fear God. What better place to be? Engraved in the palm of His hand. Kept by the power of God. Him going before us. Him going behind us. Him being the foundation we stand upon. Him being a pillar of cloud, pillar of fire by night, overshadowing us. Holy Spirit of God, comforter, leading us on the inside. The Word of God. Him sitting on the throne in heaven. Friend, we ain't got nothing to be afraid of. Be of good cheer. It is I. Be not afraid. Just fear God and act by faith. What fear? What fear is moving you and I tonight? What's controlling our actions, our decisions, our desires, our movements? There wasn't many moved by the fear of God like Noah. Just him and his wife, three sons and three daughter-in-laws, eight souls saved through the flood, friend. Could it be what's wrong in the world we're living in? Why people are dropping out of church? Why people are quitting on God? Why people are in panic? Men's hearts failing them for fear? Could it be they're letting the wrong fear control their actions and their life? Wondering what if, what might happen? When all kinds of bad things could happen, if not for the grace of God and His protection, friend. But be moved by the fear of God. God Almighty, His authority. Act by faith. Do all of what God says. Not part of it. Not when it's convenient. Not when you feel like it. Not when the world wants to go along with it. But moved by the fear of God and say, you know what? I'm going to preach. I'm going to witness. I'm going to testify. I'm going to sing. I'm going to hand out gospel tracts. I'm going to bow my head in public. I'm not going to be ashamed of the one who died for me. Not going to be afraid, friend. I'm going to trust in the Lord. I don't know about you, but I believe God will help us have revival, help us have obedience, dedication. If we get that fear of God back in us and say, Lord, I'm not afraid to trust you. No matter what happens, I'm willing to lay down my life for the cause of Christ. If it's to bring Him glory, friend. What fear is moving you and I tonight?